Hi, this is MC Shetty for a new episode of my modding tutorials. And in this episode we are going to make a little puzzle game. And I start by showing you the end result so that you better understand what we are aiming for. So these are the blocks that we are going to make. They are called puzzle blocks. You can make a puzzle as large as you want. And if you give one of them a redstone signal, it will set up a game. So let's see. That's wrong. Fish. Oh, bread was... Yeah, so we solved that one. That's easy. And because we had an odd number of items, we couldn't solve the last one. And then you can reset it again for a new game. So that's what we're going to make. To start with, we're going to make a new package. Puzzle. And let's start by making some copies. So first we have the puzzle block itself. It's a simple generic block like we have made before, the identity provider. It has an orientation and it has a boolean state indicating if it's open or not. These are all standard things. We also use the T as R, which I will explain in a moment. So the identity on block activated, when the player right-clicks the block, we have to delegate that to the activate method in the tile entity, which will do all the work. This is for redstone. This is called whenever redstone changes, and we can then get the power, redstone power from neighbors, and we also set that to the tile entity. Get state for placement, where we also set the direction, and we start by closing it. Because open is just a boolean, we have room, we have one bit left where we can encode it, so that's what why the meta contains this too. And because we need to render transparency, this will be explained later, but we have a transparent part, which is the window to which you can see the item, and the solid part. And I will show you in the block state how that works. So now the tile entity. So the tile entity is a tickable. It has an item which it's initialized with empty. This is the item it's displaying. This is the redstone power that goes into the block. This is a timer that is used when the game is showing a wrong solution to the player. So the player just opened two puzzle blocks, and then the timer will be set to delay closing it again. And this boolean indicates if it's solved or not. This is an important function. If you have a situation where the meta value of the block changes, for example, when you open or close the puzzle block, the meta value will change. We will do set block state in the world to prevent so the default implementation of shoot refresh actually compares the complete state, which means that if state differs, so if the open state differs, our tile entity would be refreshed, and that we don't want that. We don't want to lose that information, so we only check the block and not the entire state. This is important. This method, it's not strictly needed for the other tile entities in this tutorial, but if you have a generic tile entity superclass, you should probably put this code there. This is for redstone handling. So if we have a redstone signal here, we call set power, and if the power changes and it is greater than zero, we set up a new game. I will explain how that works later. This is the item solved, and this is for the logic which will I explain in a moment. And for now I'm ignoring that. This is called every tick, and on server side, if the timer is, if we are displaying a wrong solution, we will decrease the timer, and when the timer is zero, we close again. For later, that's the activate method, which is called from onBlock activated here. These methods again, like in the furnace, we used that before. These are for when the item changes, or when the solved solution, the solved state changes on the server side, we have to communicate that to the client. So that's what we do here. Both the get update tag as the get update packet, as well as the on data packet. Finally, we save our state, so the power, the item, the timer, and solved to our NBT. So let's copy the render as well. So this, we used TSR before in something is wrong still. Oh yeah, that's for later. So we used the animation TESR for our animation example, but this is our one we write ourselves. So it's a client side, and it's a tile entity special renderer for tile entity. First, we check that we're still on the right block. That's important because there are situations, because it's in another thread, that this can already, if the block is broken, the block can already be error even when our tile entity renderer is called. Then we disable light map for the to don't have any lighting for the items we display. By the way, that's what this is for. This will display the item in our puzzle block. So push matrix should always be paired with a pop matrix. And here it's important in this kind of function to always restore the state to a sensible solution, to the state that you know that is needed. And also set the state that you know that you need. So disable light map, then you should do enable light map as well. These ones you can leave like it is, because that's how they should be in this state. Here we set up rotation. So after translating, we set up rotation depending on what's the front face of our block. So we check the facing property, and depending on what side it is, we set up rotation and translation differently. So if we have an item to display, we show it here with these two methods from Minecraft, and also we scale it to make it big enough. We enable, this is a helper that sets various OpenGL states for rendering items in a GUI, and this is just standard item lighting again. And in this method, we render a highlight, that's the green rectangle, to indicate that we have solved the puzzle. So that's, we call that here. By the way, if you want to experiment with these translations and move things around, you can do that easily from within the game and recompiling at runtime. That works fine. So we have to add this to our mod blocks. That's our new and like that. And we also need to register it and or register our tile entity. Then in mod items we have to register our item block as well. So let's put that in there too. Just standard stuff that we have done before. So on the code side everything is there. Let me first explain the logic a bit because it's a bit more complicated. First let's start with setup game. So first we call find all blocks participating in the game. So find participating blocks. How does this work? We make a to-do queue for our blocks that we have to check and we push our own position to it. We also check in what direction we are looking because we only want other blocks in our game that are facing the same way. This is where we collect all game blocks, that's also what we return at the end. And while the to-do is not empty, we pull one from the to-do list, we make sure it is loaded, and we check that it's a puzzle and that it's the correct block and that it's facing the correct way, and then we add it to our game blocks. So this method will already have removed it from to-do, and here we add it to the game blocks. And then here we iterate all six directions of the block to see if these should be added as well. But we only do that if the axis is different. For example, if we have a block that's facing upwards, then the axis of our block will be Y, and we only want to see to move in directions different from Y to make sure it's all on the same plane. And then we say if we didn't already have this block, if game blocks doesn't contain this new position, we add it to the to-do. And so this loop keeps on running until the to-do is depleted. So that's a fairly efficient way to find all game blocks. And by doing this, you ensure that it will not accidentally chunk load things that it shouldn't. So we find all participating blocks. Then we make of this list, the list of items, we make a Java list and we shuffle it. So that randomizes the items. And then for every two blocks, so we also get all the game blocks, we make a list of it and we also shuffle it. And then for every game block, we can use assert here because we know that the game block will be a good block. We don't have to check that, but to avoid IntelliJ from giving a warning here, you can put that there. And so what do? We close the block and we set the item to this index. So that's from our randomized list of items. We divide the index by 2. It's integer division. So that the same item will be assigned to 2 blocks. And this is a safety in case we have a really big set of blocks that we will wrap around if we run out of items in this list. So this is to set up our game. So it will close. So what does close do? It closes me, which sets the open to false and plays this sound. We set the item, we set solve to false. That's what this method does. Okay, so that's when a new game is started. Then we have the activate method, which is called when the user right clicks the block. So first we check if the block is open. If it's already open, we do nothing. When it's open, we don't want to do anything. If there is no item, we have no game, we do nothing as well. So it's not participating in the game, nothing to do. Otherwise, we find all participating blocks again. And we check if any of these blocks is currently busy displaying a bad solution. Let me is displaying bad solution. So how does that work? We iterate over all blocks. Because we know the blocks are good, we don't have to check. And we see if the timer is greater than zero. If there is one block that has a timer greater than zero, we know we are displaying a bad solution. And then we have also do nothing. Then we count all open blocks which are unsolved. So is presenting possible solution. So we count all blocks presenting a possible solution, and that's here. We're presenting a possible solution if the puzzle is not solved, if this block is not solved, and it is open. So, if we are not, if we have no open unsolved blocks, we can open me. If there is one open unsolved block, we can also open, and then we have to check if the two blocks that are now open represent a good solution. So we do check solution. We start by assuming it is a good solution. We find all blocks that are presenting a possible solution, and we check if the item is equal with the item we are showing in our current tile entity. That's the one that was just opened. And if it's not the same, we say good solution is false. Actually, this can be more efficient, like that. We can immediately return false here if we have not a good solution. So if we have a good solution, we place an experience orb from vanilla, and we mark a solved. If we have a bad solution, we play the villager sound, and we set the bad timer. So mark solved will go over all blocks presenting a possible solution, is set solve to true, mark dirty, and it will notify the client because this has to be displayed client side. If it's not a good solution, we set the bad timer for the two blocks that are presenting a solution, and we mark dirty. And then in this one, we will close these again after the timer has expired. So that's basically it from the code side. Now for our model. First let me copy the models. Art. And let me show you what I made. So this is our block that we used to display this. It's in fact possible to make it using JSON as well, but I personally like Blender, so that's why you do it in Blender. Yeah, we have to add this. Like that. And we have let's first copy the model. These. So, first we have the exported block from Blender, and we just use the vanilla texture for it, for oak planks. That's the object file. This model is a single plane that represents the window that we overlay on top of the item. And this one is the plane that represents the stone plane to cover up the solution. And then in our block state. So what do we have? First, our model is Forge multi-layer because we have the normal model, solid, and the translucent. That's for the window. These have to render in different passes. And this is also why he had these two. So we can render in solid pass and in translucent pass. That's always with graphics. Transparent things have to be rendered in a separate pass from the solid stuff. So that's what happens here. Forge multilayer can do that. And it has a solid part and a translucent part. So this is for our direction. This is the solid model. It's our object, our puzzle object. And this is the transparent window, which we use puzzle window here. Like that. And then we also have a submodel for our blocker. So if it's open, true, we don't display the submodel. If it's closed, false, we display this submodel with a cover of stone. So that's basically how this works. So let's try it out. Actually, let's not try it out. I just noticed I forgot the textures. We use vanilla textures for these, but we do need one texture for the transparent window. So again, okay, let's see. So puzzle, and we also need a button for the redstone signal. So let's in this example make a more irregular shaped make it more complicated. As long as it's connected, it will work. But to show you that these won't work, I'll do that too. Oh. Okay. So normally these are not active. And it works, the game. It's actually pretty fun to play. Okay, so we again had an odd number. And you can play another game. So this concludes this tutorial. I hope you liked it. It showed a few things like redstone, reacting to redstone, how to use multilayer, how to use the SRs, and so on. So see you next time. Bye bye.